What's up, you guys? It's Alex here. Thank you for stopping by today. So today we're gonna talk about the three top investment tips.
Or else what the rich don't want you to know.
I'm gonna talk about things that they might have a little bit of a fancy name, but if you stick until the end, you'll find ways to apply these things into your own daily life. So without further ado, let's start and jump right ahead. Point number one. So secret number one is asymmetric risk-reward returns. This is a fancy name for saying you have to protect yourself from the downside. And what this means is, let's say that you find an investment and you're gonna put some money down. When that happens, make sure that you protect yourself from the downside first. In other words, let's say that you find an investment that you feel comfortable about putting money in. Don't risk your money. Find an investment which protects you from the downside. An example of that is when Richard Branson, the billionaire that has the Virgin Company and the Virgin Group, decided to go into the airline business, which is a very tough business to be in. So when this guy decided to go into it, he had the biggest opponent in the airline space, British Airways. Now, what he did, he went to Boeing, the company that makes the jets, and he negotiated a deal on which he could return the jets that he was going to buy from them. I think he started with 10 jets and get his money back within a year. So this is a deal that he made, and you know that the competition is fierce, but he knew that his main opponent is not British Airways. He knew that his main opponent is his own deal. So he made sure to protect himself from the downside of his own deal. So if things went great, great, he was going to be in business, make money in the airline space. If things didn't go as planned, he was going to return the Boeings and get his money back and find another investment to invest in. That's a great example of asymmetric risk and reward returns. Asymmetric in the sense that the downside, it doesn't equal the upside. If things don't go your way, you protect yourself from losing money. And if things go great, sky is the limit. So that's a great example. So when you find a deal or an investment, make sure that you protect yourself from the downside first and don't start chasing returns. Don't go like a teenage boy in a candy shop or in any kind of shop. Oh, and by the way, the best thing that asymmetric risk reward returns can do for you is
help you smash that like button down below. Do it.
And this brings me to point number two, which is not losing money. Asymmetric risk reward returns go hand in hand with the secret number two, which is not losing money. And this is explained this way. Let's take a hypothetical example, and let's say that you have $100,000 saved up, hard-earned income, and you have them on a savings account and you want to invest them somewhere. Now let's say that you take this money, which you've worked your ass off to save, and you want to invest them somewhere. Now let's say that you find an investment you feel comfortable about and you understand and you want to put the money in. So you put the money in and then it's 2008 and then you lose half of what you put down. And now your investment is worth $50,000. And let's say that you panic and you get your money out and you put them in your savings account again. Here's what's going to happen now. You have $50,000. And in order for you to break even and go back to $100,000, you need to find an investment which is going to return on your money 100%. Which means just to break even and go to where you were before, you need to put your money in an investment, whatever is going to be, the stock market, a rental property, something else, you know, that's going to return on your money 100%. So you can go from $50,000 back to $100,000, which is the amount you started from. And that's what the rich take advantage of. They know that losing money is the biggest hit you can take. You might break even, you might not have the returns you expected, but you have to make sure that you don't lose money. Because if you lose money, then you're in deep trouble. Then you have to find another investment that returns 100% on your initial investment just to break even. And this brings me to another point. Asset building. Let's define what's an asset first. So an asset is something that puts money in your bank account month in and month out. And what I mean by that is some people think that their house is an asset, and there might be if it's used the right way. But by definition, an asset is something that puts money in your bank account every single month. If you own your house, that doesn't put money in your bank account every single month. I think the opposite, pretty much, if you have to pay a mortgage or something. Let's take an example, for instance. Let's say that you have these two people working for the same insurance company, George and John. Now, let's say that George, he always wanted to live big. He always wanted to live the life, have the fancy car, have the fancy wife, have the fancy house. So let's say that they both, George and John, make $100,000 a year. And now let's say that it's the end of the year, they've both been working for the company for 1 year, and they get a bonus of $50,000. Now this bonus, George, the high spender, decides to spend it on a brand new Mercedes-Benz, fancy and powerful, and he's gonna impress his friends, and he's gonna impress his family, and he's gonna impress everybody. Now let's take John. John takes these $50,000 and uses them smartly. He puts them as a down investment to a rental property, and then he uses the bank to get the rest of the money. So now it's January, and George has a brand new Mercedes-Benz, and John has a rental property making him, let's say, $2,000 a month as a passive income. You know, things seem pretty much similar. They both go to work every day. George goes to work with a Mercedes. John goes to work with a Toyota. But, you know, they make things go by. Now, next December, things go well for both of them, and they both make, let's say, as a bonus, $60,000. So now they take this money, and George decides to go, and he always wanted the boat. You know, he worked hard. He's been working for 2 years nonstop. He's been making money. He's earned money and commissions. So he decides to buy that boat for his family and friends. And they go out, and you know, it's a fancy toy, and he loves it, and he loves showing off, and that he has a nice job and status and prestige, and you know, all these things that they come from the societal approval. Now, John, on the other hand, you know, he's more modest, he lives within his own means. He decides to put the $60,000 that he got as a bonus to another rental property. And he refinances the first house that he got now, and now he can buy a third rental property. So now, John owns three rental properties, and let's say that each of them make him $2,000 each a month passive income, so $6,000 each. And George, what does he have to show for? A depreciated Mercedes and a brand new boat. Let's say that these two people kept going on the same way, and you know, the gap kept growing. One person is building assets, the other person is spending their money. And asset building is what makes you rich and wealthy. Hard-earned income, especially if you spend it this way, is never gonna make you rich. Now, you know, you see, John can take this passive income and put it into a brand new car that he always wanted, or a brand new boat, or a brand new house for him to live in, which is fancy. But he's never going to run out of money, for the main reason that he has this passive income coming in every single month because of his assets. And George, on the other hand, he can cry on his boat that he doesn't have enough money to maintain it. That's the difference. You can buy the things that you want. Just run them through an asset first. This can be the stock market in a safe environment. This can be a rental property. This can be a business, this can be anything. Just make sure that you're building assets first and then proceed into spending and buying the things that you really, really want. And now let's talk about secret number three. The secret number three is that the wealthy people, the really rich people, they never play the game for the short term. They are never looking for that hot stock, for that penny stock, for that investment that's gonna make them billionaires overnight. They play the long game and they're patient. They invest in things they understand and they invest in things that they know. They invest in things that they feel comfortable about, and they invest in people first. With all this attention-seeking media around, there is always the next hot thing. There is always gonna be the next hot stock, the next hot property to buy. But if you play the game for the long term, you don't really care what's going on like today and tomorrow. You're playing the game for the long term, and you are buying and holding for the long term. That can be stocks, that can be rental properties, that can be anything you can name of, like a business, any kind of asset that puts money into your bank account. But they don't play the game to become rich tomorrow. They don't go out and buy a scratch ticket or play the lottery. They go out, save their money, and buy things to make their money way down the future. They don't play the game for the short term. They're patient and they're playing the game for the long term. They're chasing returns in the future and they don't want to become billionaires tomorrow. Everybody wants that. But especially dabblers, people that jump from thing to thing to thing, they never go deep. They'll never have the chance to grow deep roots into something. If you don't play the game for the long term, if you don't invest in people, if you don't invest in people, things that you understand, if you don't invest in things that you really feel comfortable with, you're gonna blame everybody and think that the world is against you. But it really isn't. You just have to play the game for the long term. With that said, there you have it, guys. These are the three secret investment techniques that the rich use. Now, here is another thing. This might sound fancy and you're like, oh, you know, that's That's not something that applies to my life, but let me tell you something. If you apply these things and ideas into a smaller scale or a bigger scale, depending on where you are in life, if you apply them to your own life, there is always maybe a deal you're about to do that you could do differently to protect yourself from a downside. Or there is another investment out there for you that you're about to do, so make sure that you protect yourself from losing money. Or maybe there is this thing that you heard about cryptocurrency or about dropshipping that you heard recently and you think of putting money in. That's very short term. I mean, if you want to do it, but first make sure that you play the game for the long term. Is dropshipping or is Amazon FBA or is all these things that people like for you right now? Or is this is something else that you want to do and you want to go out there and invest for the long term? Don't be a prey of people's attention gimmicks. People seek attention too much. Make sure you play the financial game for the long term. Don't ask to be rich tomorrow. Make sure that you're gonna be rich and wealthy for the long term. This is what financial freedom is, being wealthy for the long term. So with that said, guys, this brings my video to an end. Thank you so much for watching. Smash the like button down below and let me know what you want me to talk about next. Oh, and by the way, I was really serious about smashing that like button down below. It really helps the YouTube algorithm, you know, it pushes my videos out. So if you have some time, smash that like button.